Oh. Velkommen til Oslo Freedom Forum.
Welcome to the Oslo Freedom Forum. We know some of our dissidents are passionate rebels, but please follow these rules to help us run the conference smoothly. Please be seated and turn your phone on silent now. Be respectful of the speakers. They have worked very hard and have traveled long distances to be here. Please be present and be on time. Many of you have also traveled great distances to be here. Honor your own time. If you have a laptop or an iPad, please sit in the back of the theater so that you do not disturb those around you. Additionally, there is a lounge available just outside of the entrance to the main stage, where you can watch the program while working. If, for whatever reason, you have to leave the theater, please do not use the center aisle while leaving or returning to your seat. If you need any help, please ask a staff member. We are wearing white badges. Thank you and enjoy the day's programming.
Good morning. I hope you got a good night's rest because you're in for quite a number of very incredible talks. I am not getting much of a reaction. Okay, so I mean, I'm going to ask you if you can for a moment, if you can please get up. Please get up. Please get up. Please get up. And stretch, 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 stretch. Yeah, move it around. Yeah, that's right. Move it around. Yeah, that's right. Stretch. We have enough room here. We have a huge theater, which is, of course, for your comfort. So we have a theater that can more than capacity for what we need to still create a good, intimate community. So this is my friend Farida. You can sit down now. You can sit down now. This is my friend Farida. And we wanted to start off by bringing up the fact that sometimes, you know, although this is a wonderful celebration of life, none of us can escape death, no matter how much we try, no matter, you know, how many pills you take or what you inject, none of us can escape death. And in April of this year, we lost an exceptional, extraordinary man. It's very rare that one can come across someone that is both, that has the intellectual integrity and heart the size of Africa, and the moral clarity to see and speak so well, and that was George Ayite. George Ayite was a founding member of the Human Rights Foundation, was at the first five Oslo Freedom Forums, and even at the very end when his body gave out, he was still mentoring people. His mind was as sharp as it can be. I would like to invite you to say something about George.
Thank you, Tor. George was probably one of the greatest intellectuals, academics, but most importantly, activists that Africa has ever known. He described two generations of Africans. They are those he called the hippo generations. And these are the ruling elite that loot our resources and plunder it, that have been in power for decades and have been preventing millions of people from living in dignity. Then he described the cheetah generation. Those are the Africans that are challenging the status quo, that are fighting to build democratic institutions upon which we can, as citizens, hold our governments accountable. And it was an honor for me as an activist from his neighboring country, Togo, because he's from Ghana originally, to have benefited from his mentorship. And I believe that the seeds of freedom and justice that he planted in that cheetah generation will eventually lead us to having an Africa that is free, democratic, with people living in dignity. So for George Ayite, it is a huge honor for me to pay homage to this great man that has contributed immensely in training young activists like myself and inspiring countless number of young people to keep fighting for justice.
Well, my colleagues have made a short video to honor the memory of George. Please enjoy.
If you have suffered oppression, you really understand what it is to be free.
They threw me in jail in Senegal in 1994. They even banned my books. And even in Washington, D.C., they firebombed my office. But I did not back down, and I won't be deterred, because freedom is not negotiable. The they that I'm talking about are the usual suspects. Murderous dictators.
George Ayite, celebrated economist, university professor, author, and founder of the Free Africa Foundation, with uncommon honesty and moral clarity, called out authoritarianism as the root cause of all the world's worst problems.
All the collapsed states, devastated economies been caused by dictators.
As a public intellectual, he challenged deep-rooted dogmas about development and aid.
No military dictator has brought lasting prosperity to any African country, period.
As a teacher, he left timeless advice to revolutionaries and reformers.
The noisy rah-rah street demonstrations alone aren't enough to oust a dictator.
The Human Rights Foundation will defend Ayite's legacy and ensure that his memory lives on through HRF's mission to promote and protect freedom and democracy in countries where they are most at risk.
Ladies and gentlemen, Yuri Revich will be performing his own composition called Prelude, followed by the title theme from the original soundtrack of the film Gladiator. Gladiators, Now We Are Free, and Storm by Vivaldi, both arranged and remixed by Yuri. Thank you.
Taliban nowadays expect women of Afghanistan to keep them deep into pain, tears, so broken into pieces. But look at me, on behalf of women of Afghanistan, I have this beautiful smile on my face, and I'm talking to you today about our dreams, our wishes, and what we want you people to help us through. My name is Zarifa Ghafari. I'm an Afghan woman. My experience is shared by millions of other women of my country. Since birth, I saw women being born into the fire of war, extremism, discrimination. Since birth, I saw women being sold for money. I saw women being stoned. I saw women and their body being born on a street following the bombings. I saw how my people and my country were being sacrificed to the ambition of outsider powers, from Soviet Union to the Pakistani occupation to the America. We Afghans have endured the level of violence in our lives that I'm definitely sure no one sitting in this room could imagine of it. But still we are here. We are standing here, we are smiling, we are spreading love, peace, and beautiful message of solidarity, unity, and strong messages to stand all together and fight for peace and love. My country have been facing a lot just because of being center for power experiences for the power superpowers of the world. As I said previously, from the Soviet Union to the new government and back to the Taliban, to the Mujahideen, to everyone. 20 years of involvement in Afghanistan and the wasteful spending of aid monies in my country, and the difference of working from the level of countrysides and the center. And the focus that not only international community, not only the government of Afghanistan, but everyone had on glory buildings, beautiful cities, and some women on the screens, some men on the screens, forgetting the countrysides, letting that same people to burn in the same fire, draw us to the current situation of Afghanistan. Afghanistan is today one of the only one countries around the world that has been more than 215 days girls are not able to go to secondary school. Afghanistan is the only one country around the globe where women have to present their programs on TV with covering their faces. Afghanistan is one of the only countries where at least the maternity healthcare services, which is so primary right of women to have it around the country, is really, really in a very bad situation. We are having women that are ready to sell their daughters to feed the rest of the family. Afghanistan is the only one country where women are allowed to beg on the streets, where women are allowed to sell their body parts, their children, their house materials, or do anything else, but not allowed to go to office, to go to university, to go to school. And the world is silent. The world is silent. Sometimes it feels not so good with, because you see how amazingly, just because of maybe we are not American or Europeans, we are being discriminated by the world. Nowadays, Afghanistan is not a headline, a hot topic to discuss, while we are experiencing the very bad limit of violence, human rights crisis, and discrimination. Freedom of speech in Afghanistan is already gone. We don't have free speech right to anyone. Whoever speaks to criticize, to solve, to judge, or maybe to advise the government or anyone else around, they get directly attacked in prison and directly held to so much of violence. International community's involvement in Afghanistan, it was always a good experience of 20 years. But now, After the fall of Afghanistan on 15, after the fall of government on 15 August, we really wished that maybe something good will happen by the passage of some time. At least, let's give a time, let's give a chance. On 26th of February, same this year, after being evacuated from Afghanistan, me and my family, by 22nd August last year, I left back home, I went back home, and I was there for 10 days. Because I wanted to give a chance, I wanted to see myself, I wanted to just, let's try once again to start a new life. But being there, what I saw, what I experienced, I was never wishing for. Restriction on women is not just a rule on them. It's clearly tried to banish all women from the country. Closure of schools for girls is clearly a smart trick to banish of women of my country. Unemployment, hunger, all every side. We women, we have been never part of the crisis of the country. We were not Taliban, we were not Daesh, we were not anyone else. We always been part of beauties, developments, and good things to our country. But at the end of this chapter, any chapter, it's us to pay the biggest price. It's we, it's the women of the country. After being present there in Afghanistan, and after seeing the crisis, I started thinking with myself that when the world is going to forget us slowly, slowly, it's the time that we need to stand ourselves and we need to do something ourselves. I started working on my organization, which I had since 2015, but I never worked for because I was busy with working in governmental offices and all that. So we started up setting a center where we are going to deliver vocational and educational training for women. We are giving services for free for maternity healthcare, from doctor checkup to the medicine. Everything is for free for widow women, and we are expecting at least to deliver this amount of services at least for 5 more provinces for this year. And finally, I think the world needs peace, love, and solidarity. No one else can give this more better than us as women, because we can fit in any type of relationship to spread this beauty, love, and peace. Let's educate ourselves, take the lead of our communities, and start leading our own communities to our countries. The woman and the world, they both need each other so much now. If Russia had a woman president and Ukraine had a woman president, would that something happening right now, would that happen? I really can't imagine. It was like the world was a beautiful place to everyone then. So let's take this moment, and finally, I ask you all to please stand in solidarity with Afghan women and pressurize your government, everyone around you, raise your voices in support of women in Afghanistan, because we are not different than you. We also want to go to Mars, man. We also want to be doctors, engineers, and like people, speakers like you on a stage. We are not different than you. And please ask your leaders to not seek differences into blood of human beings. Doesn't matter which country, which religion, which identity someone holds. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I woke up last year on the morning of February 8th, complaining to my cat I hadn't slept well. As usual, she was walking on me, jumping on me, also complaining I woke up late to give her food. It was a pretty typical day for us. And then I heard a knock on my door. I wasn't expecting anyone. When I opened the door, security agents raided my house and threatened to kill me. I had been working on a story about a 27-year-old mother who was held captive for 2 weeks in a military camp 2 months after the ongoing bloody conflict in Ethiopia began. She had been gang-raped by 15 Eritrean troops who at times took turns assaulting her for over 8 hours, leaving her spine and pelvis fractured, torturing her together with thousands of other sexually enslaved women. And I had been researching stories for some time that they marked the beginning of my own personal persecution and swear. The security agents who raided my house took evidence I had gathered and warned me to be silent. 3 days after the raid, I published my investigation about the sexually enslaved woman in the LA Times. The same day, the Prime Minister's office released a statement saying I wasn't a journalist. The supporters waged an online hate campaign against me, which aimed in discrediting my work and depicting me as a criminal. I was forced to flee. On November the 3rd, 2020, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, who I would like to note is a Nobel Peace Prize laureate, sent troops to Ethiopia's Tigray region, igniting a civil war. The conflict, which has killed thousands and left over 9 million people in humanitarian crisis, initially began as a political controversy between the federal government, led by Abiy, and the Tigray region's ruling party, the TPLF. But soon, disturbing evidence of ethnic cleansing, weaponized sexual violence, and mass starvation against the civilian population began to emerge. For months, the Prime Minister rejects reports of ethnic cleansing and weaponized sexual violence by his troops and allied troops from Eritrea as politically motivated false reports. He denied the very presence of these Eritrean troops who committed the most horrific war crimes over the course of this conflict. The government blocked all communications to the war zone and barred journalists from entering the region. All warring parties in this conflict have committed atrocities. In August last year, as they advanced the neighboring regions of Afar and Amhara, members affiliated to the Tigray forces have committed atrocities, including sexual violence and extrajudicial killings on civilians out of retribution. They've gang-raped girls as young as 12 and 14 years old. The overwhelming amount of evidence suggests Ethiopian government troops, allied troops from Eritrea, and local Amhara forces have committed the most horrendous, large-scale, systematic atrocities against ethnic Tigrayan minority, which could potentially amount to genocide as defined by international laws. Outside war zones, ethnic Tigrayans who live in the capital and the rest of the country have been rounded up by government police officers, arbitrarily detained, their businesses closed, have been taken to detention camps across the country. Many have forcefully disappeared, tortured, raped, and killed inside the camps. Others have been subjected to ethnic profiling and hateful rhetoric by government officials and activists. including the Prime Minister's advisor, who called them cancer, weeds, devil, and called for the erasing from history. In December last year, the UN Human Rights Council passed a resolution to establish independent investigation into crimes by all sides. The Ethiopian government objected the resolution and pledged not to cooperate in any kind of independent international investigation. The Ethiopian government even attempted to block funding for the UN committee which will investigate the abuses. Russia and China backed the Ethiopian government. The bid to block funding failed. But I can't help but ask questions. Why do you have to fear and object to an independent international investigation unless you have something to hide? What's more in the dark that's terrifying the Ethiopian government this much? And why are we journalists being attacked and receiving so much hate and hate for doing our jobs, for exposing the atrocities? Whenever other colleagues and I publish stories that don't suit the government's narrative, the supporters open a huge campaign of smear, online hate, bullying, and calls to violence against us. That became my everyday reality. They call me traitor, enemy of the state, terrorist, and other appalling misogynist labels, all because I chose to shed light on the truth. The sole aim of the traitors and haters to tire me out, silence me, silence the victims of this brutal war. They think by attacking me and a few other brave journalists, they can bury the truth. But the truth will always come to light. Even if I don't fight for it, it will fight for itself. It will always find ways to reveal what's hidden. I am only an instrument. I always get overwhelmed when people ask me about the brutality of this conflict. For over a year now, I have been talking to survivors almost every day. The horrors I have witnessed have left me haunted and speechless. I have gotten used to horrors no one should ever get used to. One still makes my heart bleed. The story I did for Al Jazeera in April last year was about a mother who was given a 24-hour ultimatum to flee her hometown in western Tigray alongside other ethnic Tigrayan residents of the town. As she was fleeing with her kids, the Amhara militia, who controlled her hometown and ordered the ultimatum, found her and gang-raped her. And then they inserted a hot metal rod into her genitals and burned her uterus. They told her they don't want a Tigrayan womb to give birth. A video shows Ethiopian government troops shooting and throwing bodies of young civilians to a hill. And these gruesome footages and testimonies are still coming, stealing my joy, eroding the hopes and beliefs I had in the goodness of humanity. For almost a year now, the Tigray region is under a deadly siege, with all communications blocked, no humanitarian aid, no medicine, no banking service. People are cut off from accessing their own money and their bank accounts and are dying from starvation. As an investigative journalist, All I care about is finding evidence, verifying accounts. But as a human being, I grieve for the victims of this brutal war. I expect justice, peace, and support for the victims, particularly of weaponized sexual violence. Play your part in bringing this. Thank you for your time.
Over 14 years of attending the Oslo Freedom Forum, here in Oslo, in San Francisco, New York, Mexico City, and Miami, I have listened to the most heart-wrenching presentations from people from all walks of life and almost from every corner of the world. What I have seldom understood is the geographical reference of where these lives occur. As I discuss my own country, Venezuela, destroyed by inept and corrupt leaders, supported by the who's who of authoritarian governments, Russia, China, Iran, Turkey, and Cuba, I realize that most of my interlocutors understand very little about my country. But they have a lot of opinions of what we should do. They don't understand where our thousands of populated centers are, the state of our infrastructure. They don't know where we work. They have no idea where we go, where places of worship are. They don't understand where the government commits its crimes against humanity. They don't understand where the centers of commerce are. They don't understand the epicenters of illegal activity in our country. They don't understand and do not see the remnants of our educational system. And they don't fully comprehend the vastness of the poverty that shames us as a country. As people look and try to get healed, and we talk about our health crisis, people many times forget about the environmental destruction that has left scars all over our territory. Venezuela 360, which we call V360, was born to cover this void. It was an attempt to collect and georeference as much information as we could about our country, using sophisticated techniques of information gathering, data analysis, satellite imaging analysis, and leveraging very heavily on digital mapping tools. We developed the following platform. I'll show you a very short video that explains what we have. Partnered with a number of NGOs and other civic organizations to try to collect the information that we did not have about our country. As it happens often, many organizations focus on very narrow aspects of a nation's crisis. Bringing it all together was necessary. While they helped us get the data, we helped them improve their data analytics and particularly their data visualizations. And when everything is a platform, it becomes quite interesting to watch. The first thing, as we were looking, we realized that there was a crisis going on that people were not paying attention. In the 60% of the country that lies below the Orinoco River, a pristine area, our share of the Amazon, Venezuela's share of the Amazon. We knew about rampant illegal mining. So we partnered with an NGO, SOS Orinoco, to understand the work that they had done and help visualize the footprint. And this is shown in red here. So what you see in red is illegal mining. Now, this illegal mining is occurring in the most pristine part of the Americas and includes and is decimating national parks, including Canaima National Park, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Here, we could see the overlap between the national parks and the mining. Most of this area, by the way, 80% of this territory, which is the habitat of most of the indigenous people in Venezuela, is protected territory. As health experts predicted, these mines were going to be a perfect environment for the mosquito that bears the malaria parasite. And that's exactly what happened. We now find ourselves with the second largest epidemic in the Americas after COVID-19. So we needed to find somebody who had the information. We found a health NGO and then proceeded to georeference to the precise location, 800,000 cases of malaria. Now, since multiple armed groups, including elements of the Colombian guerrilla, in cahoots with elements of the Venezuelan military, were fighting for control of the mines, what you would expect happen? Killings, massacres, and all sorts of human rights abuses, which we then paired with another NGO and had to map it too. Without collaboration with a wide group of organizations, without access to open source data, and without using the correct tools to analyze and visualize, it is very difficult to present to the world what's really going on. Here, you combine everything. So this is a picture of a situation that nobody was paying attention to. And when people talk about what's going on in Venezuela and ignore this, they're essentially ignoring Venezuela. In our hundreds of databases that we have in our platform, allows for analysis of what's happening in Venezuela right now, but it also serves to begin to plan of what we have to do in the future if we ever get the chance to survive this terrible nightmare. Venezuela 360 is a blueprint that can and should be reproduced in other countries. For this case, we had tremendous support from the Human Rights Foundation and some of their most generous donors. Open source data is, and open source intelligence is a threat to every authoritarian government. By georeferencing and posting data, you could allow easy crowdsourcing, you could identify what's really going on, and you can challenge the narrative of any authoritarian regime. Better informed citizens not necessarily would win, but it's very clear that the chances for success and change can improve. Thank you.
Hello, do you hear me? Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon all of you. I'm so happy to be here with you. I would like to thank the Oslo Forum for this invitation. It is a commendable initiative to celebrate those who defend human rights and freedoms. Many of us here would admit to often finding it difficult to talk about themselves, of course, including myself. So I will try to show you how I come to my position on political and human rights issues, as this seems more important than storytelling. I grew up in Yemen, in a family familiar with politics and law. From early on, I realized that my country's political environment was unhealthy and unstable, and it was governed by corruption, tyranny, and failure. And this tyranny led the country to political and economic failure, social backwardness, and terrorism. This inspired me to fight back. I dedicated myself to fighting dictatorship and advocating for freedoms and rights, especially for the right to free expression, demonstration, and assembly. I started by writing strong articles against the dictator Ali Abdullah Saleh, then fought a hard battle to found my NGO, the Women Journalists Without Chains. I used to be told that you have a sharp tune. You have a sharp tune. And no one likes headaches. They told me that a very conservative society like Yemen cannot be changed. Some said that women cannot change society. But my father used to tell me that I should find solutions instead of waiting for them. So I began to roam the streets, carrying a megaphone, calling on people to wake up and stand up for their rights in the face of injustice and corruption. The authorities, used to call my family and tell them, if you don't silence your daughter, we will silence her. But I never given up. Since 2006, every Tuesday, I went to protest in Freedom Square in front of the cabinet in the capital, Sana'a. These weekly and sometimes daily sit-in and demonstrations continued until we announced our great peaceful revolution on 2011. Although we were subjugated to violations, we didn't stop. We continued to demonstrate. The dictator kidnapped me and put me in the prison. He thought that would weaken me, but prison didn't make me afraid. It made me strong. It amplified my voice in Yemen and around the world. My imprisonment helped to ignite the spark. Thousands of people took to the streets to call for my freedom, for my release. They held my picture, as you say, the first time they had done this for a woman. Millions of Yemenis women and men went to the street, demonstrate peacefully, chanted the same chant that I used to. The people want to fall of the regime. People want to build a new Yemen الشعب يريد إسقاط النظام الشعب يريد بناء يمن جديد. All those millions of people, women and men, were struggling and sacrificing for freedom, democracy, justice, and rule of law. So for this, I have been called, as you say, so the mother of the revolution, and I was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize on 2011. So dear friends, our peaceful revolution led to the resignation of the dictator Ali Abdullah Saleh and to transitional period and a successful national dialogue that brought all Yemenis together. We wrote a great draft of constitution that guaranteed all the human rights values and good governance principles that we sacrificed for. But unfortunately, the forces of the counter-revolution led by Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Iran started their war against our will to democracy, freedom, and justice. They committed all the crimes against us. They were just afraid from the will of our people and from any kind of attempt of their people to dream for democracy. So they supported the Houthi militia coup in Yemen, and they waged ugly war in Yemen that caused that Yemen now is suffering from the worst humanitarian catastrophe in the recent history. So some try to blame the peaceful revolutions for the heinous chaos that has many faces, such as military coup, terrorism, the civil war in all around the Arab Spring countries. But this could not be more wrong. This did not happen because we dared to dream. This happened because our dreams scared those authoritarian regimes who are afraid from their people's dreams for justice, democracy, freedom. Since 2011, which is the year of the Arab Spring, there has been a battle between two camps, the camp of democracy and human rights from one side and the camp of anti-democracy and human rights. The dictatorship in the Arab Spring are using all kinds of tools of oppression. They have thrown and tortured tens of thousands of people in the prison. They have killed and displaced millions of people. They supported terrorism. They feed terrorism. And think by waging wars, destroying cities, spreading chaos, they will convince the West that the Arab region is not a place for democracy and human rights. And also, they will convince the world that peace and security can only be secured by tyrannical regimes. And this is a lie. This is the biggest lie. Dictators pose the greatest risk to the security of their countries. And they pose the greatest security to the global peace. Yes, dictators pose the greatest risk to internal security and the global peace. I have always believed that terrorism and dictatorship are two faces of one coin. And the time really has proven me right. Terrorism is a product of tyranny. And I have relentlessly struggling against both. So it's shameful that dictatorship have close tie with democratic countries, with democratic regimes, with democratic governments like United States and the Western governments, who turn a blind eye to the gross human rights violations being perpetrated. The tyrant and human rights violators must not feel unreachable by international accountability and justice. The tyrant and human rights violators must not feel unreachable by the international accountability and justice. For peace to prevail, the West must stop cuddling authoritarian regimes. They must stop allowing the so-called war to be an excuse to protect those dictators. Many tell me that change is not possible, but I know that we shouldn't give up. We must not give up. Change toward democracy and freedom, it is not only possible, it is inevitable. I have never thought of giving up. I'm not scared because I know time is on my side, because I know that I am on the right side of the history. The dictators, with all their strength, are the ones who are scared. They know that their time is limited. It is our responsibility here, all people here in the Oslo Forum, and all people around the world who dream for freedom, democracy, justice, and rule of law, to stand up and to keep hope alive, to fight peacefully for freedom, dignity, and democracy. Dictatorships around the world are united. So to oppose them, to defeat them, we should be united too. We have here, we are in 21st century. We have many tools that can help: technology, internet, and social media are some of the strongest tools that we have in this century. Yes, there is too much hatred and polarization, especially that is being used by the organized campaign by the authoritarian regimes. And this media, this technology is being exploited and used against people who strive for democracy and freedom. But this tool also helped us to achieve our dream and will help us. So if we invest more time and resources, we can reclaim the online spaces. I am now a board member of the oversight board of Facebook and Instagram, where I am trying to make changes on how content is moderated and ensuring that the freedom of expression and other human rights values are better respected. So our work is only a part of the solution. But I still believe that by helping journalists, activists, and ordinary citizens speak freely online, we will shake the yoke of tyranny and defeat them. So to me, to myself, to all of you, here today, we are fighting for freedom, for your people who are fighting for their people. Do not lose hope. We represent the future. The dictators are the loser. We will win this great Nobel battle. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
The Human Rights Foundation, with the Center for Applied Nonviolent Actions and Strategies, began an educational program to support activists in 2018. The artist and activist you're about to see is a Freedom Fellow from the class of 2021. Manasseh Mathiang is an activist and artist from South Sudan whose work focuses on bringing peace to his country. He is the founder of Anataban, a youth movement with more than 800 artists in South Sudan who work to bring peace and democracy. As if that wasn't enough, during his time in the Freedom Fellowship, he began Hagiga, which is an organization that seeks to empower citizens in South Sudan through art and storytelling. We truly hope you enjoy this performance and that you consider supporting HRF so we can bring this support to the activists that need it the most. Thank you.
Feel the South Sudanese groove? Are you ready to feel the South Sudanese groove? Yaoude! Bagara dance! Bagara bagara dance! Bagara dance! Bagara bagara dance! Listen to me! Come and join me, come and dance with me. Come and dance like this. Come and join me, come and dance to the beat. Well, the sound's so sweet. Shape your hands to the horn of a boom. The horn of a boom. Stamp your feet as you're feeling the groove. The feeling the groove. Yaude! 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 Afrika Mashariki, skizeni kwa makini. Hii ngoma ni za mnombo wa mawasele tu. Usinipe kisogo, just do as I do. Hii mziki mtamu, ya sinipa timu. Ya kutingisha, hadi masenzi naisha. Tunazikwenda, jasho ni natiririka.
Tiche wa mnuda,
bakara dance ya ude.
Because you guys started a little late this morning, we're going to cut into your break, which is unfortunate. Sorry, I need to catch my breath a little. You know, this conference is like being on a roller coaster, you know? You're sitting there and suddenly it's like pain, anguish, joy, sadness, inspiration, nobility, sadness, great food, massive amounts of drink, no sleep, repeat. So, if you want to hear a great story about the corruption of Jeffrey Bezos and of Reed Hastings at Netflix, make sure you're here as soon as we start at noon, after which you're going to see if you thought this morning's violinist, who was just simply extraordinary playing with that Stradivarius, we're going to have an equally good performer in the next section. So be here at noon sharp. Thank you.
We all just decided
everyone
it's over.
Is vaccinated.
Thank you.
story, gang. Huh? I love it. I love it.
Thank you. That's not sexy. I'm like, sure they're not saying it.
On January 24th of 2020, HRF's film The Dissident had its world premiere at the Sundance Film Festival. The film investigates the brutal assassination of Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi, as well as Saudi Arabia's repeated attempts to silence dissent, both inside Saudi and abroad. The Dissident premiere was a triumph. The film received critical acclaim and stellar reviews, eventually obtaining a 96% score on Rotten Tomatoes. At Sundance, the standing ovations were followed by repeated assurances from top streaming companies and film studios of forthcoming purchase and distribution offers for our documentary. The film was going to tell the world the shocking story behind the murder, and it would certainly become one of the most important documentaries of our time. But this didn't happen. Netflix and Amazon's top executives instructed their acquisition personnel to not purchase the film. Apple, Hulu, and many others were spooked by the behavior of the top two streamers. In the case of Netflix, the rejection of The Dissident was all the more surprising because Netflix's first ever Oscar was awarded to Dissident director Brian Fogel. In time, Netflix's decision made sense. In September of 2020, a Saudi government-linked company and Netflix announced they had signed a deal to produce 8 new films together. The price tag remains a Netflix secret and is estimated at more than $50 million. But what about Amazon? At Jamal Khashoggi's memorial service, the founder of Amazon, Jeff Bezos, who also owns the Washington Post, where Khashoggi worked as a columnist, declared,
"No one should ever have to endure what you did. We are here, and you are not alone."
What happened to Bezos? To our surprise, Bezos himself refused to see the film, stating this was an old chapter in his life. What Bezos didn't say is that Amazon had acquired e-commerce company Souq.com, which was the largest home distributor in Saudi Arabia and the Middle East. Jeff Bezos, now in business in Saudi Arabia, surely prefers not to upset Saudi Arabia's crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, the man who ordered the murder of Jamal Khashoggi. With the entertainment industry stacked against the dissident, HRF would turn to theatrical distribution. With the pandemic closure of all theaters, the only outlet left to HRF was to offer the film to the public as a video-on-demand purchase. Against all odds, the film became the most purchased video-on-demand in documentary history. The influence that Saudi Arabia has over Hollywood and over some of America's richest billionaires, such as Jeffrey Bezos, as well as Reed Hastings at Netflix, is troubling and immense. We invite you to watch the film, and if you've seen it, tell your friends and family. HRF has a perpetual commitment to keep the memory of Jamal Khashoggi alive and to never allow anyone to forget that his killer, Mohammed bin Salman, has yet to be brought to justice.
My brother once told me, if we see injustice and no one have the courage to speak up, then nothing will change. And that is exactly why I am here today, to speak up, to seek justice, and to speak about a true champion of change, a humanitarian aid worker, a brave human rights defender, and above all, my dear brother, Abdulrahman al-Sadhan, who is currently in solitary confinement in Saudi Arabia. We are a family of three siblings, two sisters and one brother. We grew up between the United States and Saudi Arabia. We went to schools in both countries, so we had an international upbringing. As kids, we were very close and protective of each other. My brother had a great sense of humor. He always brought us laughter and joy. He also had a great sense of compassion and caring. He looked after us and put everyone else before himself. He used to rescue injured animals and care for them. It was his caring nature that led him to refuse to stay silent towards injustice and led him to become a humanitarian aid worker for the Red Cross. However, in Saudi Arabia, there is no freedom of speech, and any critical voices are brutally repressed, and it has gotten much worse under the regime of the Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, or as he is known, MBS. The only way people can express themselves is anonymously on social media, yet they face huge risks. And while this was possible in the past, under MBS, even anonymous critics are now targeted through government surveillance, imprisoned, tortured, disappeared, and in some cases, even murdered. It pained Abdulrahman to see the injustice and the oppression. And just like many young Saudis, he expressed himself anonymously on social media. He used political satire and humor to criticize issues in the country, such as unemployment, the economical situation, the rights of taxes without having the right to vote. He called out the hypocrisy of the religious establishment that invents new religious decrees every day to oppress people. And most importantly, he called for democracy, equality, justice, and freedom. And while such an act is celebrated and considered one of our most basic rights in any democratic country, in Saudi Arabia, daring to speak up to your rights is treated as a crime. One day, in March 2018, my brother got kidnapped from the Red Cross office where he worked in Riyadh during a mass crackdown on peaceful activists and critics. We later found out that the Saudi government have spied on my brother, among 6,000 other Twitter accounts that got leaked by ex-Twitter employees that were bribed by the Saudi government. Saud al-Qahtani, the right-hand man of MBS, who is also involved in the murder of journalist Jamal Khashoggi and the torture of many activists, have threatened previously that he is building a blacklist, and he is going after anonymous activists and critics on Twitter. After 3 years of my brother's disappearance, held without a charge, he was brought to a secret sham trial that lacked all due processes and got sentenced to 20 years imprisonment followed by a 20 years travel ban over satirical tweets. 20 years imprisonment followed by 20 years travel ban over tweeting. During Abdulrahman's disappearance, he was held in a secret prison. He was brutally tortured with electric shocks, beating, sleep deprivation, just to name few. They broke his hand and fingernails, saying this is the hand you tweet with. My brother ended up in the intensive care unit for days, unconscious, fighting for his life. His last hearing was on October 5th of last year. And although the signs of abuse and torture were visible in court, yet the judges decided to ignore them. And instead, he continued to be forcibly disappeared. He is denied any calls and visits until today. But you know, my brother is not the only one who has suffered. Human rights abuses are happening on a massive scale in Saudi Arabia. Just like my brother, there are thousands who are imprisoned, tortured, disappeared for tweeting, and sometimes even without a reason. And that includes writers, journalists, lawyers, economists, scholars, researchers, musicians, humanitarian aid workers, doctors, nurses, and even students. Their families cannot speak up and are often threatened or placed on a travel ban. There are more than 65,000 imprisoned without due process or fair trial. Instead of making real reforms by improving human rights, starting with the release of all prisoners of conscience, the Saudi regime instead is whitewashing its image by sports and entertainment events and fake advertisements of reform, while actually there's more oppression going on. In fact, MBS is not a reformer. Under his rule today, there is no respect for the rule of law. There is no respect for international human rights. And there is no respect, not even to Saudi laws. He has complete control over all the Saudi institutions, including the justice system. The justice system actually protects the abusers, not the victims. The courts invent fake charges as they go and as they receive the orders directly from MBS himself. That is not justice. That is not reform. That's tyranny. As we've seen today, there is no justice for Jamal Khashoggi, and there is no justice for the victims of torture and disappearance, like my brother and hundreds of others who are suffering today. Instead, actually, Jamal Khashoggi's murderers, Saud al-Qahtani and the rest of his squad, are protected by that same system. They are currently living in luxury villas in Riyadh. You know, I've never thought I would become an activist. But because of what happened to my brother, I became more aware of the horrendous human rights abuses that are happening in the country, and I can no longer stay silent. And while this pains me, it also motivates me to speak up and speak louder. My brother had the courage to speak out, to spark a change for his country. Like many other young Saudis languishing in jail today, he sacrificed his freedom for others to have better lives, for true reforms. He and others do not belong in jail. They are Saudi heroes. They are Saudi, true Saudi reformers. On May 28th, just days away, it will be Abdulrahman's birthday. His first birthday behind bars, in solitary confinement, for no crime, tortured, disappeared, deprived of any family communication, and deprived from all his rights. Abdulrahman wanted to be a voice for the oppressed, but he is in prison today, and he cannot speak up anymore. So we need to speak up for him. He has suffered enough for standing up for what is right. And in this wonderful stage, in this wonderful theater, there are amazing journalists, activists, artists, and community leaders. With your voice and platform, you can help. Please ask about my brother every time you see anything about Saudi Arabia. Condemn the whitewashing and question the human rights abuses. Together with your voice, we can save my brother and we can save many other innocents out there. To that end, I would like to kindly ask you to take out your phones right now, right here with me, and go to Twitter and tweet hashtag #FreeSadhan. Right here, right here, right now, from the Oslo Freedom Forum stage, I just tweeted live. Join me on this call to free Sadhan and free all Saudi activists. Please do so now and every time you see anything about Saudi Arabia. Free Sadhan. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Check my live tweet, retweet, and tag me, Free Sadhan. Thank you. Free Sadhan. Free Sadhan. Free Sadhan. Free Sadhan. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I thought long and hard about this speech. I wasn't sure if you would want my honesty, or if you would want me to tell you what I think you want to hear. I wondered if I should give you an airbrushed view of activism, an avatar of heroic sacrifice. People expect their activists to be a certain way. I feel the responsibility to present as if I'm winning, or at least hopeful of victory, even when all hope is lost. Because people expect leadership, encouragement, and resilience. But the truth is messier than that. The truth is uglier than that. But it is also more beautiful, precisely because it is true. So here's the truth. There is more than a generation of Hong Kongers who are suffering from excruciating trauma. The trauma of losing their home, friends, family, roots, and identity. Activists aren't immune from it. Far from it. We aren't invincible. Speaking personally, the past year has been a profoundly dark period for me, beset by shadows and the torment of my own thoughts. I have lost many of my friends. I stand before you feeling completely powerless as my city goes into a black box, together with the silent screams of my loved ones. Independent media platforms like Apple Daily and Stan News are being cracked down upon. Journalists are being banned from reporting court trials, and many friends have been behind bars for more than a year now. I don't know if I'll ever set foot in my home again. Ever sit on a high-rise roof staring for hours at our unique cityscape. Ever fight through humidity so thick the world seems to slow down. Ever sip bubble tea chatting with friends about bags and boys. I feel like I have been deprived by Beijing of my identity as a Hong Konger. I no longer belong to my city, and there is nothing out there for me. Sometimes I would have nightmares about these things and wake up to a pillow wet with tears. Many fellow activists have endured much greater losses. Some have lost families. Some protesters made the ultimate sacrifice. All of us have lost our freedom of speech, freedom of conscience, and freedom of expression. I was told we are brave, we are honorable, and we are noble. We are portrayed as some mystical creatures, like unicorns, who fear nothing. Not the loss of friends or loved ones, nor the jackboot of a stormtrooper. This image is reinforced by well-meaning parliaments and organizations who are trying to help. But not everyone could understand what it cost us to relive our ongoing trauma. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is feeling fear, but still deciding to do the right thing. We all have that courage embedded within us. But it comes at a cost. It is a sacrifice. and for the entire community of Hong Kongers, it is an ongoing sacrifice. So here is what I came here to say. Our sacrifice isn't just for us. It is for you. We don't fight just for our home. We fight a way of life that you share. Our loss is also your loss. The fall of Hong Kong represents the expansion of an authoritarian regime. And if you think the border of that state will stop at Hong Kong Island, I invite you to think again. We give it all so that you would wake up to the threat posed by a brutal, expansionist, and highly strategic regime. We give it all in the hope that if we go down fighting, at least it will help the world to reform its approach against the Chinese Communist Party. I'm sorry to say that the international community has not honored our sacrifices. While our youth languish in prison cells, the international community refuses to move beyond empty hand wringing. The United Kingdom, for example, made promises to defend our autonomy and our way of life. These promises were sealed in an international treaty lodged at the UN, the Sino-British Declaration. China has completely torn up that treaty, and the UK hasn't even registered an objection to it. They haven't done anything whatsoever to try to hold China to account. At their countries watched as Beijing continued to crack down on us. They failed us and continue to fail us. We deserve better than that. You deserve better than that. And if everyone does a little more, we would be living in a much better place. Although this is not the cultural disposition for Hong Kongers, we are slowly learning to be angry about it. Those of us who managed to get out are scattered all over the world, and our movement is entering a new phase. It would make sense for me to put before you a call to action, say, support the diaspora more, provide us with resources. While that is actually needed, there is something that's needed even more. That is for you to stand up for what you believe in. And that means holding China to account for what he has done to my city and by extension, your way of life. We are here to demand more. We are here to demand that promises made to us are honored and that Xi Jinping is being held to account for what he has done to Hong Kong. And if you think we're gonna give up because of the current situation in Hong Kong, you underestimate our resilience. As I face into my future, I would love to ask you to see us as we are. Not unicorns, not special, not invincible, just people picking up the burden of activism and trying to bear with it, day in, day out. Honor the sacrifice Hong Kong has made for you and press your governments to stand with those who held an umbrella into a wind of tear gas to defend our common values. We aren't going away. Please stand with us.
ها هنا الآن بين شظايا الشيء واللا شيء نحيا في ضاح الأبدية نلعب الشطرنج أحيانا ولا نابوا بالأقدار خلف الباب ما زلنا هنا نبني من الأنقاض أبراج حمام قمرية نحن من نحن ولا نسأل من نحن ما زلنا هنا نرتق توبة الأزلية ولنا نصف حياة ولنا نصف ممات ومشاريع خلود وهوية نحن أبناء الهواء الساخن البارد والماء وأرض النزوات البشرية عاطفيون بلا قصد ها هنا فيما تبقى من كلام الله فوق الصخر نتلو كلمات الشكر في الليل وفي الفجر فقد يسمعون الأبدية الآن الآن بين الأمس والغد تغسل امرأة زجاج السماء لا تنسى ولا تتذكر الآن السماء نظيفة وخفيفة الآن يسألني صديق ما هي السعادة الآن؟ ما هي السعادة الآن؟ ثم يمضي قبل الجواب الآن بين الأمس والغد برزخ متموج ومؤقت يقف الزمان كأنه يقف الهنيهة بين منزلتين الآن ترتفع التلال لترضى الغيم الشفيف وتسمع الإلهام والغد يا نصيب الحائرين الآن فيما تبقى من كلام الله فوق الصخر نتلو كلمات الشكر في الليل وفي الفجر تبقى من كلام الله فوق الصخر نتلو كلمات الشكر في الليل وفي الفجر فقد يسمعون الغيب لفتى منا بسطر من نشيد الأبدية
and nothing. We live in the suburb of eternity. We are who we are without asking ourselves who we are. because we are always here. And we have half of life and half of death and dreams of freedom and eternity. Mahmoud Darwish. Now, the next poem is by Ibn Zaydun, a great poem from the time of Andalusia. He wrote it when he left his native country and went to exile. He wrote it for his lover because she decided to stay. I dedicate it to all those who leave the country with the hope on one day they come back. Kama tasha.
أبداً تحن إليكم الأرواح ووصالكم ريحانها والراح تكلفوا ستر المحبة والهوى فطا بالسر باحوا تباح دماؤهم وكذا دماء العاشقين تباح فكما تشاء فقل لي لست منتقلا لا تخشى مني نسيانا ولا بدلا وكيف ينساك من لم يعرف بعدك ما طعم الحياة ولا بالبعد عنك سلام أتلفتني كلفا أبليتني أسفا قطعتني شغفا إلا لا إن كنت أدمرت السلوى فلا بلغت يا أملي من قربك الأمل يا ولا اتخذت سواكم من دونكم بدلا والله كمان تشاء
I have hope, because without hope it is impossible to live.
Václav Havel, the poet, the playwright, the dreamer, the revolutionary.
The Václav Havel Prize for Creative Dissent.
Because dissenting is the best verb to conjugate liberty.
This award is hope. And a message to those voices that are out there that no one is speaking for them.
Dictatorship is not a political issue. It is a moral issue.
Governments and dictatorships are so scared of art.
They want to close my mouth because I choose the most peaceful tool to criticize them. I choose poetry, verses, words.
Theater has good power. We have got power to provoke emotions and start a debate immediately.
So I would like to dedicate this award for the voiceless.
Even though we may be going through great darkness, it's up to us to realize that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Václav Havel said, "Hope is not the conviction that things will turn out right, but the certainty that what we do without caring what the result will be."
And we together can change our society.
Dear friends, this welcome resumption of the Oslo Freedom Forum, previously made impossible by the COVID-19 pandemic, coincides with the anniversary of 33 years since the fall of communist dictatorship in Central and Eastern Europe. And 31st years from the collapse of the USSR. At the time, 24 countries re-entered the democratic space, with 11 of them previously incorporated in the former Soviet Union. The Cold War that had lasted in 45 years was at an end, finally offering peace a chance. Now we are faced with a new Cold War, while in Ukraine the Russian Federation is waging an altogether hot conflagration, thereby returning the horrors of the Second World War to the contemporary limelight. Affirming our solidarity with those that are fighting in Ukraine for their own country's freedom, as well as our resolve in standing with those suffering from this unwarranted invasion, today's award of the Václav Havel Prize is a welcome opportunity to commemorate those that stood up against repression during long and bloody Soviet dictatorship, fighting for liberty and democracy at the price of their own lives and on their own freedom. As one who has spent 50 years under dictatorship, as one who was directly involved in the overthrow of the totalitarian regime in Romania, I am here today to offer you all a testimony of an emblematic personality who inspires us in our own struggle for freedom and democracy, Václav Havel. I met President Havel 31 years ago in Prague, when he was already president of the Czech Republic, and when I was adapting his ideas to the civic movement I led in Romania. As rector of the University of Bucharest, I had the pleasure of awarding President Havel to the title of Doctor Honoris Causa. We were close collaborators as presidents of our respective countries, and a strong friendship continued to tie us long after, until his untimely demise. Havel was an informal leader of the family of first democratic presidents from Central and Eastern Europe, who hailed from the academic and cultural milieu of their respective countries. Today, his ideas are perhaps more applicable than ever before, both though regarding the power of the powerless and his belief that truth and love will vanquish lies and hate. If it's not possible to peacefully dismantle the most criminal regime in the history of mankind, the Soviet Empire, responsible for tens of millions of deaths, through a non-violent movement called the Velvet Revolution, 3 decades ago, why would the same feat be impossible today? Those who will make such a victory of the good a reality will be people much alike the presence here tonight in the Oslo Concert House. Or those I met during previous reunions of the Oslo Freedom Forum. Creative and courageous individuals that can mobilize those around them in the struggle against repressive regimes. These fights against evil not end anytime soon. In years to come, other generations will come to understand just how much they owe those who had the wisdom and bravery to fight in their stead. Now, towards my later years, after life lived during the Second World War as a refugee, then under a criminal dictatorship that succumbed to a popular revolution, followed by a difficult economic transition that bore high social cost, I wish to confess to the depth of the appreciation and respect I feel for you. I am certain that my dear and old friend, Václav Havel, would also have been proud of you today, as would the other in that family of early democratic president of Europe that are no longer among us. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank Thor and Gary that 3 years later we could be together again. 15 years ago, in Washington, a new Statue of Liberty was unveiled, a bronze replica of that built out of paper by Chinese students in Tiananmen Square. I attended that dedication as a survivor among the Eastern European presidents that founded the memorials of the victims of communism. I am glad to be able to offer this symbol as a sign of the Havel Prize for Creative Dissent to Marina Ovsyannikova. Hope is not the conviction that things will take a turn for the better, but rather the conviction that you are doing makes sense regardless of the turn things take, for better or worse. Congratulations, yes, Marina. This is welcome to the free world. We also need the people to fight for truth.
Much for this award. To be honest, I didn't expect it at all. When I first read George Orwell's novel, 1984, I was a journalism student. And this is a social fiction. In future Russia, it would be impossible, I thought. It was 1998, the time of Yeltsin democratic reforms. Now it seems like ages ago. I was wrong. In just 20 years, Russia has become a totalitarian state. Now people are being jailed for saying no war. And the president of this country is a war criminal. In 20 years, Putin has destroyed all independent media in Russia. Instead, he built a cynical and lying propaganda machine. It works following Goebbels' philosophy, constantly calling black white. For many years, Russian media have been teaching people to hate Ukraine, the United States, and Western Europe. We all know what the disaster this led to. February 24th was the point of no return for me. It was a shock. After my protest on live TV, my children said that I had ruined our family's life, and they kept asking me why I did it. In this life, one must sometimes to do similarly irrational for the greater good. I want my children to live in the free country that doesn't attack neighbors in the dead of night and doesn't threaten the world with nuclear weapons. I know that million Ukrainian women and children are feeling right now. I know what it's like to lose everything and become a refugee. I had such experience. I was a child when the first war in Chechnya began. My house was reduced to rubble. That's why I hate war. Any war is death, pain, and ruined lives. George Orwell wrote, "The fastest way to end a war is to lose it." It's hard for me to talk about it, but I don't see any other way for my country. Russia must lose this war as soon as possible. The light must triumph over darkness. Thanks again for this award. I wish to use this money to help Ukrainian refugees.
Art is about feelings and associations. To me, this particular artwork brings back memories from my childhood in the mid-80s in Iran, taking Peykan cabs around the city with friends and family. Peykan was a preferred car for taxi drivers in Iran at that time, and they used to fill them up with friends and strangers. I remember being 14 people in a cab to travel around. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to give this prestigious Havel Prize to the artists of the Peykan Project. I hope they come soon.
Thank you, Mahmoud, and I'd like to thank the Human Rights Foundation for its incredible generosity to the Peykan Arkar and all of us. I'm Mark Wallace. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the Peykan Arkar and its co-founder. I'm delighted to be here today with all of you to receive the Václav Havel 2022 Prize, particularly to be with you, activists, artists, and dissidents from all around the world who use art, creativity in words to fight tyranny. Victor Hugo wrote that the ugly, horrible, hideous thing can be made beautiful in the realm of art without losing anything of its monstrosity. Percy Shelley believed that this mimesis is an instrument of moral good because it allows man to imagine intensely and comprehensively the pains and pleasures of others. And of course, For Dostoevsky, in 1869, beauty will save the world. Diasporas are often fountainheads of creativity and ingenuity. The more they thrive, they live, they create, they serve as the beautiful riposte to the tyranny left behind. The Iranian diaspora is exemplary, vibrant, and dynamic. Wherever they settle, they meet with success. Iran, in the wake of that diaspora, remains a land of oppression, a land where human dignity has no currency, where being queer is punishable by death. The Pacan Arkar is a beautiful thing that seeks to address a monstrous concept, and it springs from the mind of Persians, Iranians in exile. Dr. Hiva Fazi is the heart and soul of the Pacan Arkar. She's its co-founder and executive director. Her father, Mir, and mother, Azar, left Iran in 1998 for the express purpose of finding opportunity and dignity for their daughters. We honor Mir and Azar today for their sacrifices for their family. My good friend Alireza Shojayan is the first Pacan Arkar artist. He fled Iran and left his family and all he had behind for fear of his life. It's horrific. It's horrific that most of the queer community in Iran is recognized when one of its souls is lost in the embrace of death, hanging from a construction crane. We hope to change that. It is my great privilege and honor to work with the creative and brave Hiva and Alireza. Hiva.
Our canvas is an iconic Iranian automobile. When the Pacan began rolling off the factory line in 1964, it was the first Iranian fully manufactured automobile. It immediately became a symbol of Iranian pride and industry and offered Iranians freedom, modernity, and hope. That legacy we hope to continue. In the same way that every Iranian aspired to own a Pacan, we aspire for every Iranian to live free and with dignity. The Pacan Arkar was born from that belief. This particular car was gifted by Shah of Iran to the dictator Nikolai Ceausescu in 1974. A car that was once a gift to a dictator is now a beautiful symbol of Iranian human rights. Since the Islamic Revolution in 1979, Iran has become a place of deep systematic discrimination against the LGBTQ community. Just this year, in a national address, Khamenei described homosexuality as a moral deprivation. Unsurprisingly, in this context, Iran's LGBTQ community often finds itself systematically persecuted within broader Iranian society, a society that has been taught to believe that being queer is shameful. We plan to continue the journey of Pacan Arkar as a beautiful symbol of human rights. For the next edition of the Pacan Arkar, we will commission a female Iranian artist to use it as a medium to raise awareness of the gender-based violence and a systematic abuse of women perpetuated by the regime. Today, though, we celebrate our first collaboration, which has been exceptional in every sense, as Alireza has transformed the Pacan Arkar into an incredible cri de coeur of LGBTQ community and rights. Thank you again for the great honor, and thank you, Alireza.
Thank you for the choice of the Pacan Arkar to pick a subject which has been kept as a taboo for many years. And thanks to the recognition of the importance of this choice by the Human Rights Foundation, I have the opportunity to share a few words with you. I'm glad to be the first artist to transform this historic paycon to an artwork to bring awareness to the horrific living condition and violation of human rights against my fellow LGBTQ plus community in my home country, Iran. The main inspiration comes after the tragic death of Alireza Fazeli by his male relatives in May 2021, simply for being gay. Alireza's death is a cruel reminder to all of us of the systematic violence we LGBTQ people face in Iran on a daily basis, either as a result of government oppression or society. The anti-LGBTQ laws, and more specifically, the capital punishment, is the cause of displacement of many Iranian LGBTQ people inside and outside of Iran. Those who manage to escape end up being trapped in Turkey for years, a country that is increasingly putting more and more pressure on their own queer community and queer refugees. Sadly, after enduring years of hardship, only a small number of these people get placed in a third safe country where they would need to start their lives from zero again. It's needless to say that my experience as an Iranian queer person has not been an easy one either. But I'm glad that with the safety and freedom that France granted me, I am able to do an artwork like this in which many people might find their voice. I'm sure there are so many others who have the same potential, but just because of not having this privilege, they are not able to express themselves. I hope those countries that can grant a safe home to the people like me continue to do so until a day no one has to leave their home country simply to be their true self. Thank you.
It's heavy, huh?
It is.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you.
I'm Badil Tao. I'm a Chinese artist. I make art to giving nightmare to a dictator like Xi Jinping. And today, I'm going to... And today, I'm going to introduce one of my great friends, a much bigger guy, who also give nightmare to a lot more dictators. But before this, please allow me to reading a list, and I also need your help. Take out your mobile phones, notebook, and this is some important names. Hens, K-H-E-N-C-A-R-T. George, J-O-R-G-E-T-O-R-R-E-A-L-B-A. Lilia, L-I-L-I-A underscore K-U-A-T T-S-A-B-A-Y-A. Beast Bernice. B-E-A-S-T-B-U-R-M-E-S-E. P-X Molina. P-X-M-O-R-I-N-A. Marisa. M-A-R-I-S-S-A underscore N-A-H-A-N-E-E underscore D-S-I-G-N. And Ali. K-H-A-R-I-D-A L-B-A-I-H. These are my fellow dissident artists. These are the people who are really brave. You know, we are not worrying about or be afraid to be exiled or knocked the door by the police or be putting into all kind of threat. But what makes us really struggle is lack of platform to showing our artworks, to having this platform to tell the general public. Last year, a great figure makes a game change. Enes Kanter Friedan, one of the top players in the league, decided to use his supersized shoes as a canvas for all of the artists that I just mentioned to display the artwork regarding all the human rights issues, especially in China, like the Uyghur genocide, the Tibetan people's struggle, the Hong Kongers' struggle. Enes Kanter Friedan has been known for his activism against the Turkish dictator Erdogan for years. But last year, he decided to take this to a whole new level, using his shoes to providing platform, millions of audience, which is something we as dissident artists dreaming about, but always having difficulty to do because of the censorship and threat. This brave action does not come without a price. Enes has been shadow banned by the NBA League. He has been banned by China. But he is so brave, he never breaks down. And he's continuing his marvelous, marvelous campaign. So today, we're celebrating this prize with all the dissident artists, and mostly to the big man with the big heart, Enes Kanter Friedan.
Appreciate it, brother. Thank you so much.
Congratulations, brother.
Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Okay. Ooh, that's pretty heavy, actually. I'm just going to take this off because it's getting hot in here. Okay. Whew. Okay, well, you're talking about changing the world with talent. You talk about Baricio. He's a living proof. First of all, I want to take my time and thank the HR family. I wanted to give their name because they've been doing an amazing job just organizing this, and next year is going to be the 15th one. So, Thor, Gary, Celine, I don't want to forget any of them, so give me a time. We talk about Javier and my hero, Jenny. You know, there's so many people behind the curtains who's working so hard to make this event happen, so I want to take my time and thank them first. And here, you guys can clap for them. It's not for me, it's for them. The second thing is, you know, so this week is my birthday week. You know, I appreciate it. So I appreciate it. I just turned 30, so I feel like I'm getting old. But every year, I used to celebrate my birthday with my family since 2015, right? Then dictator Erdogan took over, and he revoked my passport, put my name on Interpol list. And unfortunately, you know, the last 7-8 years, I'm away from my family. So every year, the night before my birthday, I was praying to God and saying that, please, God, give my family back so I can have one more birthday with my family. Then I came here to Oslo. In the last 3 days, I met with so many heroes, so many brave people, and I realized today, I was like, my wish did came true, you know? God gave me the freaking coolest family that I could ask for possible. So that's one. So about the shoes, so he was one of the creator of the shoes. So I wanted to, as you guys see it over there, whenever I was a little kid, whenever I watched an NBA game, the first thing I looked at, I watched, was the shoes. What kind of shoes they're wearing, what brand it is, what color it is, if it's comfortable. So I wanted to create these shoes to inspire everyone but our future kids, our young generation, because they're going to be the one who's going to make some real change. So we wanted to, this is the Tibet one, and we can just go to the next ones, but I wanted to create these shoes and bring awareness about what's going on around the world. So we made with so many, this is an Uyghur shoes, and we wanted to create these shoes to just go out there and wear it, and now everyone I've seen, every kid I've seen is asking for the shoes. They're like, where can we buy them? So I'm gonna start producing them soon. So the one thing, the last 3 days, I came here and listened to many stories. And every time I listen to a story, obviously, my heart was breaking. And it's a really tough situation, obviously. Because I wanted to learn about not just the things that are happening in my country, but all over the world. Problems are happening all over the world. But one thing that really, got my attention, people are coming here and talking about all these problems. Okay, so what's the solution? That's, I think, the one thing that we need to find out. I wanted to put that seed in your guys' brain. We come here talking about the problems. We come here talking about, people are dying. There's political prisoners, this and that. But what is the solution? What can we do? We always say, don't just talk about it, be about it. What can we do to bring some real change? What can we do to bring some real, if you come here and talk about it all day and then go back to our countries and forget about it, then this is a waste of time. So I feel like we need to come together and bring some real change. I'm an athlete, so I have a box of friends. I tried to learn how to box. It did not go too well because I was too tall for it. But my boxer friend was telling me, he gave me a really good advice. He's like, I'm going to teach you something. I said, okay, go ahead. He said, as a boxer, if you punch a guy with your hands open, you're going to break your hand, right? If you make a fist and punch your opponent in the face, you're going to knock him down. So I asked him, what are you talking about? I'm not going to go out there and fight. In real, I'm just trying to get in good shape. He said, individually, right? You guys might be heroes. You guys might be the bravest people that I know. You guys might be so good, so amazing. But don't forget, you guys are trying to fight against a government. You guys are trying to fight against dictatorships. So individually, we might not be strong enough to go against the whole country. So that's why we need to find a solution to come together and fight as one, and punch all the dictators in the face around the world and knock them down. So, yeah. With that being said, we talk about the solution. I feel like the first step is the attending Oslo Freedom Forum, and the second step is donating. They told me to say that. I'm just joking. But other than that, man, I want to say I'm really humbled to be here. And this award, I'm dedicating this award to you guys because I feel like without you guys, I'm nothing. Because there's a really good, I play basketball. It's a team sport, right? We always say one for all for one. So I feel like I'm accepting this award on behalf of you guys, and I'm dedicating to this beautiful award, to these beautiful heroes here and beautiful people here. And thank you guys for having me. I appreciate it. And my last thing for you guys, if you guys ever in America, please let me know. I would like to invite you guys to one of my games. So thank you guys. Really appreciate it. Thanks for having me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh my God, Thor, how are you doing, my brother? How was everything? Good. How was everything?
Thank you.
I know. Good? How are you doing?
Thank you.
That was everything.
Thank you. Great. Sir? Amazing.
We feel like little munchkins next to you. We feel very, very small. But Ennis,
yes.
Absolutely wonderful. This is essentially a lovely way to end the programming that is taking place in the theater.
Yep.
We are now going to go to lunch, and then there's some interactive sessions. But Celine and I wanted to come out, and do you want to continue?
Yeah, we wanted to say that this forum is a labor of love by a small team at the Human Rights Foundation who have dedicated time, energy, and passion to make this experience happen. So I'd like to call my colleagues
Gus?
To come on stage so you can see the face behind this work and this experience, which we hope you enjoyed. So please come up, Electra. All of you. Everyone.
Stand back.
Enjoy this experience. Make sure you're here next year. The dates are June 5 to 7.
Nobody's back there because the staff is here, but there's supposed to be a slide with the dates.
It's right here.
There you go. There you go. There you go.
We're prepared. We're well prepared.
Okay.
So June 5, 7, make sure to be here and share with people around you so we can elevate these stories and make a change. Thank you for being here and thank you for listening.
Okay. One quick note for lunch. We have a couple of options for you. I'm like the lunch guy at this point. If you go down and out through the front doors, there's that beautiful archway just as you walk out. Down the stairs, past the one building, and then you'll see signage and you'll see like these kind of silhouettes on the door. That is the National Theater Conference Center. That's where lunch is served for all access guests. We also, I know I keep saying it, but the Art and Protest Lounge is still open.
Art and Protest Lounge is exceptional. Yeah. It is, unfortunately, you have to go down the steps on the theater and then go round the building. It is so worth it. Bring handkerchief. It is so worth it. And it's the power of the exhibits there. Do not miss them, even if you only swing by for a couple of minutes.
Yep. Pillar of Shame, I believe, I think that was at... I would have to check a document. It is on the schedule, though.
It's on your schedule.
Yeah.
It's on your schedule.
I think it's coming up right now. Yeah, I think it's 1:30. Yeah. And that's at the university. It's just past there. Thank you all.